voce. Lovely evening, the first Christmas evening of the year. With snow, I mean, it looks like we are already Christmas time. That is our Christmas spirit. We are happy to be here anyway, to because we have tonight a wonderful talk, which is part of what we have organized in conjunction with the exhibition of drawings by Michelangelo that some of you might have already seen at the art gallery of Ontario. They come from Casa Buonarroti in Florence. And the exhibition you see around here is also something that wants to enhance the image of Michelangelo. He doesn't really need to be enhanced, to be promoted. I mean, he's such a great genius. But we wanted to show you also how a modern photographer, a contemporary photographer, interprets Michelangelo's sculptural work. And these photographs are made by Aurelia Vendola, who is one of the best Italian art photographer at the moment. He has a very long career on his shoulders, and he has this very special exhibition of images that go from the early Michelangelo of David and the Pietà, Vatican Pietà, to his latest work, which is also a Pietà Rondanini, which is also in your book, Sara. Tonight we will have the pleasure of listening to Dr. Sara Prodan, who is going to talk about Michelangelo, but as more the other aspect of such a genius, which was his poetry writing. And his word in general. The study of Sarah, which is a wonderful essay, Michelangelo's Christian Mysticism, came out this year and it was published by Cambridge University Press. We have a few copies, if you're interested, to examine and also to buy later on. The talk regards the other aspect, as I said, of Michelangelo's, in particular, is poetry. Sorry?
Less known.
Less known. Yes, it is less known to non-Italians, actually, because we at school, in our secondary high school, we study Michelangelo's poetry, too. So we are familiar with his sonnets, with his love sonnets, with his style, which was called, I remember from my studies, Rime Petrose, because they were harsh. The language of Michelangelo was harsh, was not as fluent and sweet as in other contemporary poets. Sara is a post-doctorate fellow of the Victoria College at University of Toronto. She's worked and she's still there working at the Center for Reformation and Renaissance Studies. She's made her dissertation under the guidance of Professor Konrad Eisenbichler, who's also been here with us many times, and I'm really glad to have her here and to talk about Michelangelo's and his poetry. Grazie, Sara.
Thank you, Dr. Zainab, for having me here. Michelangelo, his poetry is art. In their study of the melancholic temperament of artists throughout history, Rudolph and Margot Whitcomb observed that Michelangelo has been qualified in almost every way imaginable. There cannot be many adjectives that have not, at one time or another, been used to characterize his personality. He has been called avaricious and generous, superhuman and puerile, modest and vain, violent, suspicious, jealous, misanthropic, extravagant, tormented, bizarre, and terrible, and this list is far from being complete. Among the other descriptors one might add to their list are inspired and insightful, dedicated and devout, and strikingly, if not polemically, transgressive. These adjectives would likely come as no surprise to someone familiar with the 302 poems and 41 fragments comprising Michelangelo's extant literary corpus. Much like the man, the poet defies categorization. For many of you, Michelangelo Buonarroti needs no introduction. He is the sculptor of the David, of the Moses, and of the Roman Pietà that bears his signature. The first known autographed work of public commissioned art in the Western tradition. He is the painter of the Sistine ceiling in Rome with its famous finger of God that I've just jumped over in the creation of Adam scene, and of the Last Judgment that he subsequently added to the altar wall of that same chapel. In the two decades before his death, he served as the architect of St. Peter's, chief architect of St. Peter's in the Vatican, the heart of the papacy and of Roman Catholicism. And for those of you who have had a chance to attend the AGO's current exhibit, Michelangelo Quest for Genius, you have seen firsthand evidence that he was an expert draftsman and one of the first artists to polish drawings as presentation gifts to friends and to acquaintances. Two of the most famous being a drawing of the Titius for the Roman nobleman Tommaso di Cavalieri, and a Pietà for the religiously reform-minded intellectual Vittorio Colonna. If you were ever surprised to learn that Michelangelo was also a poet, fear not, you are in good company. His poetry has received far less attention than his other works, and this was true in his lifetime, and for many decades and centuries after his death, his poetry was scarcely known. Michelangelo was the most famous artist in Italy for a good part of the 16th century. The seeds for our present-day distinction between artisan and artist were sown in his day and through his very success. Well known and sought after throughout Europe, he found himself in a unique position of being of greater celebrity, though not necessarily of higher social class, than some of his patrons. He has been described as an artist, the artist most committed to verbal expression before William Blake. And though there has been almost as much written about Michelangelo as about Shakespeare, comparatively little of it pertains to his writings. We possess approximately 1,500 sheets containing drawings, poetry, and other notes or records written by Michelangelo, including menus. We have just above 1,800 letters written to by or about Michelangelo, and this from a man who made a point of destroying many sheets in his possession. If we leave aside popes, rulers, and saints, it has been estimated that we have more archived or preserved material on or from Michelangelo than from any other individual from the Middle Ages and the Renaissance. In addition to these primary sources, biographies were written about him in his own day, as were literary dialogues that staged his persona. Selected Michelangelo verses were commented publicly or privately and subsequently shared. Some of Michelangelo's poetry was put to music by the foremost composers of his day, and this tradition continued in the 19th and 20th centuries in Italy and abroad. The catafalque or funerary monument erected after Michelangelo's death at the Church of Santa Croce in Florence includes statues for all four of the arts that he mastered: sculpture, painting, architecture, and poetry. Yet historically, the reception of his verses has been quite fraught. First, the unique transmission history of his poetry is such that Michelangelo's verses were neither well nor accurately known until the end of the 19th century. Second, the challenge of critically commenting upon the ancillary literary activities of a renowned artist and a cultural icon was plausibly threat enough to discourage thorough investigations or analyses of his work. Then there was the idiosyncratic and untraditional nature of the poetry itself, which featured irregular forms, harsh sounds, and male dedicatees for love poetry. On the one hand, it was difficult to understand Michelangelo's verses, and so they were not widely or thoroughly read. In general, he was praised for the philosophical depth of his poetry, or its content, but criticized for its style and form. His poems were considered by many to be unrefined, unconventional, and uncanonical. In short, Michelangelo was a genius, but also a mere versifier. The matter of whether or not the Florentine poet had literary ambitions is indeed among the most interesting topics in the history of Michelangelo criticism. Should his poetic corpus be considered the intellectual or creative output of a writer, or rather as the personal and private confessions of a man? There is no simple answer, but if one were to offer one, it would be this, that his writings were both and neither. Michelangelo's verses range from seemingly spontaneous and at times confessional lines on highly polished pieces, such as this one. Here we have a drawing of two Davids, one in anticipation of the marble sculpture, and one for a different David that is now lost. And here Michelangelo has written on the side, Davide colomba e io col varco. David with his sling and I with my bow. The bow either referring to an artistic tool or perhaps to his intellect, we're not sure what comparison Michelangelo is going for here. But he was known, on this same page, he included a quote from the famous Italian poet Petrarch. And so his poetic beginnings began with his own lines and quotes from others that one finds in various places. Brief compositions that he wrote or that he quotes from others appear at various angles beside or on the reverse of letters, notes, and other drawings, some of them from very different periods than the time of his writing. Equally labyrinthine are a number of variously and vigorously reworked poems that he developed at length and in contrasting ways, and that he took pains to structure and refine. Approximately one quarter of his poetry appears on sheets with drawings that do or do not relate in obvious ways to the verses themselves. And one-third of his drawings include writing for some form. Unfortunately, I only have this in a photocopies of the original sent from the Vatican itself, but it's enough to see that he wrote sometimes development of one idea in different directions, and other times notes on the reverse of columns and other drawings, and sometimes with letters on the reverse shining through. All of this making it incredibly difficult for anybody who's tried to say, this is a Michelangelo poem, this was his definitive version. On the sheet on the left in particular, I think we have the first version of a poem that appears in different sheets in four different ways. And so he was really quite committed, but also quite spontaneous and erratic in the way that he approached the writing of poetry. Michelangelo's first exposure to poetry likely occurred when he was a teenager, resident from 1490 to 1492, in the house of the Florentine ruler and noted patron Lorenzo the Magnificent, where he met foremost thinkers and philosophers of the Italian Renaissance. It is not known with certainty when Michelangelo first began crafting verses, but our first records date to the period of 1503-1504, and it would appear that between 1542 and 1546, he was revising his poetry with an eye to publishing it, about 89 pieces. His literary activity progressed through at least three distinct phases, and each period is characterized by a different style and approach, or by a multiplicity of them. What I will attempt to provide here is an overview of this multifaceted and rare collection of verses, beginning with some of his earlier work, and then progressing to a more detailed discussion of his writings on love that simultaneously touch on the matters of his spirituality, his career, and his concerns as an artist of largely religious works. Between 1503 and 1555, composed approximately 55 poems with a rate of one poem per year for the first 20 years, many of his writings from this period do consist of brief scribbles. Poems range in content from commentary upon contemporary events to seeming exercises in the popular Petrarchan style of love poetry, with an emphasis on the poet's suffering. One of the most memorable from the period concerns Michelangelo's painting of the Sistine ceiling, which he undertook between 1508 and 1512. It's written here, with a drawing beside, which is meant to represent Michelangelo working in awkward positions on the very vault of the Sistine ceiling itself. And the English translation by James Sassler reads as follows. I've already grown a goiter at this drudgery, as the water gives the cats in Lombardy, or else it may be in some other country, which sticks my stomach by force beneath my chin. With my beard toward heaven, I feel my memory box atop my hump. I'm getting a harpy's breast, and the brush that is always above my face, by dribbling down, makes it an ornate pavement. My loins have entered my belly, and I make my ass into a crupper as a counterweight. Without my eyes, my feet move aimlessly. In front of me, my hide is stretching out and, wrinkling up behind, it forms a knot, and I am bent like a Syrian bow. Therefore, the reasoning that my mind produces comes out unsound and strange, for one shoots badly through a crooked barrel. Giovanni, from now on, defend my dead painting and my honor, since I'm not in a good position, nor a painter. We learn more about Michelangelo from this autobiographical piece than the fact that his work on the Sistine Vault was grueling, and that he had a sense of humor. First, the poem is addressed to someone, a humanist scholar, actually, Giovanni di Benedetto da Pistoia. Michelangelo did, in fact, write much poetry for the purposes of sharing it with others, in letters. This kind of poetic epistolary exchange was typical of the educated elite in his day. Second, we learn that Michelangelo was prone to self-deprecation, whether this was feigned or real. Third, he considered himself a sculptor, first and foremost. He never considered painting his art. Fourth, he drew playful cartoons, one that in this case is meant to complement the poem, but that at other times appear on sheets passed back and forth between the artist and young apprentices in his service for the purpose of their education or their entertainment, and not all of them are clean. Fifth, Michelangelo did not adhere rigidly to usual poetic forms like the sonnet, or in this case, the sonetto caudato, sonnet with a tail. In this case, he added an extra three lines that one wouldn't expect at the end. And while this might not seem shocking to a contemporary audience, the fact that Michelangelo was playful and transgressive with these forms had a much more significant meaning in the period and could even be considered, in some cases, quite political. Michelangelo's humorous poetry was not always accompanied by related drawings. Oftentimes, of the 200-some sheets that feature his drawings and his script, the result is a curious juxtaposition indeed. Consider the following parody of a fashionable love poem that flanks an earlier sublime drawing of a merciful Madonna and child. You have a face sweeter than boiled grape juice. It looks as if a snail has walked across it, it shines so much, and prettier than a turnip, and teeth as white as parsnips, so much so that you could entice the Pope. And eyes the color of a medicinal brew, and hair whiter and blonder than a leek, so that I'll die if you give me no relief. Your beauty seems much more beautiful to me than any man that's painted in the church. Your mouth, it seems to me, is like a sack filled with beans, just like my own is. Your eyebrows seem tinted from the frying pan, and curved more sharply than a Syrian bow. Your cheeks, when you sift flour, get red and white, like poppies in fresh cheese. When I look down upon each of your breasts, you look like two watermelons. They look like two watermelons in a bag. So that I'm set on fire just like tow, even though I'm worn and broken by the hoe. Just think, if I still had the cup of beauty, I'd follow you through the other girls like a hound. So too, if getting blocks of stone were possible, I would make incredible things here today. Poems as humorous and grotesque as these comprise a very small proportion of Michelangelo's literary production. It almost seems a sacrilege that a drawing as beautiful and sacred as the Virgin Mary should be tarnished by a poem so base. Was Michelangelo making a point of some kind? Was he simply so frugal that reusing a sheet was the most pragmatic way to proceed? Did he view this addition as a corrupting influence on his previous work? If so, did he add it out of irritation at being unable to continue with his sculptural work? He does compare it to the impossibility of becoming young and attractive and chasing young women. Michelangelo's Herculean struggles with patrons and with his craft were well documented in his own day. In the ensuing centuries, anecdotes provided by the artist's contemporary biographers and by his own records and writing fueled the imagination of many a commentator of his art and also his poetry. And Michelangelo's displeasure with one patron in particular, did make its way into his art. This particular sonnet from the Sistine Ceiling period is one in which Michelangelo criticizes Pope Julius II, on whose tomb he has been working as a sculptor when the Pope suspended the project to the artist's dismay, and then shortly thereafter commissioned him to paint the vault of the Sistine Chapel, perhaps upon the promptings of jealous rivals who wished to see Michelangelo diverted from the tomb to the ceiling project. My lord, if any ancient proverb is true, it shall be this one, that one who can never wants to. You have believed fantastic stories and talk, and rewarded one who is truth's enemy. I am and have long been your faithful servant. I gave myself to you like rays to the sun. But you don't suffer or care about my time. And the more I exert myself, the less you like me. Once I hoped to rise up through your eminence, and the just scales and the powerful sword were what were needed, and not an echoing voice. But heaven is the one that scorns all virtue, if it puts it in the world, and then wants us to go and pluck it from a tree that's dry. The scales and sword point to Pope Julius II, who is known as the warrior pope, as does the reference to a dry tree in the closing line, secco. This is a veiled reference to the pope's surname, which was della Rovere, with Rovere denoting oak. Michelangelo had allegedly left Rome out of exasperation at being ignored, and not paid, perhaps, by the pope. The enemies of truth, or liars, mentioned in line four, were likely the painter Raphael and the architect Bramante. Competition was fierce for papal commissions, and Michelangelo succeeded in working for seven popes. From the autobiographical or grotesque compositions that we have just read, some of you may find it surprising that Michelangelo went on to compose some of the most exquisite love poetry, an elevated spiritual verse in the Italian language. The famous Veronese composer Bartolomeo Tramoccino scored one of Michelangelo's first love poems in Naples in 1518. And I have a copy of this that I will play for you, but I'll read it first in English. How will I ever have the nerve without you, my beloved, to stay alive if I dare not ask for your help when leaving you? Those sobs and those tears and those sighs that came to you with my unhappy heart, my lady, testify distressingly to my impending death and to my torments. But if it is true that through my absence my faithful servitude may be forgotten, I leave you with my heart, which is not mine. This quintessential madrigal about unrequited love emphasizes the elements of sacrifice and subjugation typical of the poet lover's confessions and soliloquies in Michelangelo's verses. Let's listen to this madrigal. It was composed for four voices.
Thank you.
what that would have sounded like. Approximately four of Michelangelo's madrigals were put to music in his lifetime, but many composers have attempted to create appropriate accompaniment for Michelangelo's verses. One such composer was Benjamin Britten, British composer, who in 1940 wrote an operatic score for a rapturous sonnet Michelangelo had sent to the young Roman nobleman, Tommaso de Cavalieri. I'll read this one. This is the only poem I read in English and then in Italian. If one chaste love, if one sublime compassion, if one fate are equally shared between two lovers, if the hard lot of one troubles the other, if one spirit, if one will governs two hearts, if one soul in two bodies is made eternal, rising both to heaven with similar wings, if love with one blow and one gilded dart can burn and rent the vitals in two breasts, if neither loves himself and they love each other, with one joy and one zeal to such a degree that both might wish to come to a single end, thousands and thousands would not make a fraction of such a love knot, such fidelity, and only anger could untie and break it. Here we have a perfect sonnet with two quatrains with the rhyme pattern A, B, B, A. A, B, B, A, huh? Followed by two tercets with the rhyme scheme C, D, E, C, D, E. The entire poem is one sentence long and constitutes a well-developed if-then argument that resolves in the final tercet. The repetition of sun, if one in Italian, lulls the reader into the dream of perfect spiritual love that the poet lover expresses and that is poignantly embodied in the Neoplatonic image of their two souls rising to heaven on shared wings in line 6. And now I'll read just the first stanza in Italian to give you a sense of that lull. Sul casto amor, su una pietà superna, sulla fortuna intra due amanti uguale, su un'aspra sorte a non dall'altro cale, su un spirito sul volere d'un cor governa. You continue if you like. Su un'anima in due corpi è fatta eterna, ambo levando al cielo e col pari ale, se mor d'un colpo ed un dorato scale, il viscer di due petti arde e discerna. Ma l'uno l'altro in nessun medesimo, d'un gusto e d'un diletto e tal mercede. Sono fin voglia l'uno e l'altro porre, se mille e mille non sarei in centesimo, a tal nono d'amore e tanta fede, il solo sdegno il può rompere e sciorre. The concluding verse about anger is believed to imply that the actual delicatessen of the poem, Cavalieri, was misled by others into thinking that Michelangelo's intentions toward him were less than noble, that is, homosexual and not platonic. In 1532, Michelangelo met the young, handsome, and graceful nobleman, Cavalieri, who would become a lifelong friend and who would inspire an impressive number of compositions. In the early to mid-1530s, Michelangelo also met the nobleman and poet Vittorio Colonna, a beloved soulmate of the mind to whom he would dedicate, or by whom he was inspired to write, a comparably abundant number of poems. During the 15-year period between his introduction to Cavalieri and the equally pivotal event of Colonna's death in 1547, Michelangelo actively composed approximately 200 of the 302 poems that we have. Many of these were love sonnets and madrigals, dedicated to or inspired by Cavalieri or Colonna, and possessing deeply and increasingly spiritual undertones. After Colonna's death in 1547, Michelangelo's literary production declined substantially, owing largely to the physical suffering he experienced during what seems to have been a painfully protracted twilight portion of his life. He died a mere 6 weeks before his 90th birthday. The poems he composed across his lifetime focus on guilt and divine grace, which seem to define the rival antipodes of the poet lover's inner landscape. Okay? In his poetry, the lover frequently figures as trapped by conflicting desires. And I would like to explore this theme a little further by taking a very close look at one poem in particular, Sistina, G70. The recurring words upon which this poem is constructed establish a motif of binding and freeing of the poet lover. In the opening stanza, the poet laments that his malevolent ruling planet binds his power and his will to such an extreme that he exists like a vacant ship on a blustery sea. O cruel star, or rather cruel will that constrains and binds my power and my volition, there's been no bright star working for me in heaven since the day on which my sail was unfurled. And so I have wandered about and gone astray, like an empty ship turning in every wind. Now I am here, weary, and in those inflamed winds, I must launch my boat, and without any will, plow those same high waves over which I've always gone. Fatigued, apathetic, and buffeted about by the fiery winds of his ardent passions, the poet lacks the will to set sail as he should for the destined port, to begin the salvific return voyage to God, steering his ship aright through the turbulent waters of sinful desire that have always led to his undoing. In the remaining three verses of the stanza, of the second stanza, the marine motif, not sure why this hasn't loaded, here we go. The marine motif gives way to arboreal imagery, alluding to the fall. The poet describes humanity as eternally appropriating Eve's apple, by which it suffers and is bound. Thus down here is seized, and it crushes, and it binds what earlier was plucked from a tree up there. Because of this, the poet has excluded himself from heavenly reward, and by which I've deprived myself of the gift of heaven. The general pictorial designators up here and down there distinguish the branches of the tree where the fruit first hung from the ground below where it was figuratively recovered by Eve's descendants. This underscores the distance, if not opposition, between heaven and earth, prelapsarian and postlapsarian humanity, God and the poet. Drawing attention to the polar skyward and earthward ends of the tree, the poet evokes its verticality and thus the purifying ascent to God that the Christian pilgrim was meant to pursue. The present tense description of humanity's sinning as a metaphorical resumption of Eve's apple plucking suggests that this action is ongoing, ceaseless, timeless, ahistorical happening that accounts for the poet's own graceless state, as it does that of his brethren. Yet the speaker additionally implies that his exile from grace and divine presence, the symbolic meaning of the tree of life into which the tree of knowledge transforms after the fall, results from the poet's own interior choices. He has denied himself heavenly gifts by having personally picked up the bitter fruit of sin that his ancestor had so disobediently procured. Michelangelo's anthropomorphized tree of knowledge and life in the original sin and expulsion scene on the Sistine ceiling is similarly paradoxical in giving joint rise to the snake and to the angel with the flaming sword that banishes the damned pair, that is, to the respective means of their exile from God and the Garden of Eden. It is not all that clear in the fresco who is more to blame. Adam reaching for the branch, Eve passively reclining on the barren land below him, or the serpent inciting them to temptation. Perhaps this is Michelangelo's point. The simultaneous emergence of the serpent and the cherubim from the conflated central tree points directly to God as the architect and origin of the whole tragic event, thus suggesting the providential return to which the expulsion will ultimately give rise, and so ultimately to the happy plan of human redemption through Christ. In G70, Michelangelo contrasts the poet's personal choice to sin with the shared post-lapsarian condition of humanity by which the collective cannot help but seize the proverbial apple. He highlights the paradox of Christian existence. Bound by consequences of a choice not of his choosing, Eve's insubordination, the poet must elect to change that which he is neither truly free to select nor to alter by his will alone. G70, much like the Sistine ceiling narrative of the fall, encompasses the cone-like flight of earthly Christian existence, understood in terms of salvation and original sin. I am expelled so that I might return, guilty, though not fully to blame. Responsible for my own repatriation, I am unable to effect it by myself alone. Yet, I am exclusively accountable for this hopeless state, because I perpetuate it through the very weakness of my desire for change. Next, the poet reflects upon how accountable he truly is for his desires and his deeds, as he seeks to remedy his penchant for sin in light of how powerless it renders him. The speaker describes himself as driven not by heaven, but rather by his passions, which he assimilates to mysterious, strong, and unforgiving winds, an external force that ineluctably subjugates and binds him by neutralizing his will. Here it's not heaven that controls and moves me, but rather the harsh and powerful earthly winds, for I don't know what's been unleashed on me to give them a hand in taking my free will from me. Thus another net besides my own now binds me. Thus baffled and forcibly bereft of volition, the poet questions whether he can be held truly or fully accountable for his inscrutable choices. Is it my fault if I went towards it unawares? He curses the astrological circumstances in which he was born for predisposing him to sin. Then he tempers the attack by conceding the undeniable existence of free will. Accursed be the day when I first moved beneath the sign that was passing over in heaven. Although I know that the day does not bind the heart, nor compel the soul in unfavorable winds against the free will liberally granted to us since an ordeal set us free. The gap here is Michelangelo's, this line is incomplete. But the closing verse of this fourth stanza, when the clause on hardship in the closing verse of this stanza, indicates that liberation is, so that hardship is a means of liberation, and it is a clear reference to the providential significance of human affliction and its salvific value in redirecting Christians to God for relief and also for redemption. This aspect of trial as a divine instrument is further developed in the next stanza, where the speaker recalls how in the past his sighs and prayers were met with mercy by an empathic God who, upon reflection, was not fundamentally antagonistic toward him. Therefore, if pain ever let loose spreading sighs from my heart, or if it moved through hot winds, praying to him who is beyond our will, heaven taking pity on my hot winds sees, hears, and feels me, and is not against me. The sixth line in the stanza points to God's role in reversing man's essentially self-generated and self-perpetuated and binding agony. The doleful assertion that humans require divine intervention to extricate themselves from their self-imposed bondage is repeated in the first two verses of the next stanza, where it lends a litanic quality to the text, thus setting the stage for the ensuing prayerful appeal to Christ that the poet's will be subsumed under that of God. One who binds himself loses control of his own actions, and no one has ever untied himself by himself. And as a tree grows straight up toward heaven, I pray you, my Lord, though I strayed so long, that my will may, like one who has had no wings, come back underneath your greater will. In his supplication, the speaker resumes the arboreal motif of the second stanza by a simile that compares the poet's journey to God with a tree rising toward heaven. Trees do naturally rise heavenward. As nature, they reflect God's image and his will, and so ascend effortlessly. Individuals, the argument goes, are naturally drawn back to God by that which is good in them, even if this is none other than God's presence in man through the operation of grace. This sestina is a prayer and a confession. Double desire, or conflicting desire, is a central topic in Book 8, The Confessions, where St. Augustine laments the monstrosity of having a will that does not respond to the mind's commands. Michelangelo's spiritual poetry appropriates this language to an uncanny degree, and not only in this religious poem, but in others as well. Who is this who leads me to you against my will? Alas, 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 bound and confined, though I'm still free and loose. If you can chain others without a chain, and without hands or arms you draw me in, who will defend me from your beautiful face? Like Augustine in the Confessions, Michelangelo, the poet pilgrim, is free, yet bound by his own inordinate response to pulchritude and its false promises of pleasure. In Michelangelo's verses, beauty appears as an enticement to sin on the one hand, and as a means to salvation on the other. The eyes being the proverbial gateway to the beloved's interior, as well as the means by which the lover apprehends the divine within it, The beautiful visage of the idealized love object becomes the sign of God's presence in the world and the vehicle through which the faithful are drawn back to him. And Michelangelo's poetry consistently alludes to this type of ascent. In Madrigal G107, Michelangelo the poet describes a luminous astral emanation whose gravitational-like effect of attraction at a distance magnetizes its beholders through the desire it stirs within them. For from the highest stars descends a brilliant light that pulls desire toward them, and down here is called love. Given the respective desires of his eyes and his soul, the poet deems the contemplation of beautiful objects the exclusive way for him to ascend. My eyes, desirous of beautiful things, and my soul, likewise of its salvation, have no other means to rise to heaven but to gaze at all such things. The rhyming of salute, salvation, and virtute, means or possibility, draws attention to the poet's hope for redemption. A defining conceit or concetto of Michelangelo's poetry, this ascent motif appears in his writings in countless and contrasting ways. In the closing terzo of Sonnet G83, the poet emphasizes the redemptive effect of contemplating pleasing, sensible forms. To people of good judgment, every beauty seen here resembles more than anything else does the merciful fountain from which we all derive. Nor have we another sample or other fruit of heaven on earth. So he who loves you in faith rises up to God and holds death sweet. With its figure of allusion to God as a merciful fountain from which humanity originates, this sonnet is explicit in Christian language. The poet concludes that individuals who have been freed from lust may perceive the Creator within the creature, and that it is this divine emanation to which they are truly attracted. Having submitted their senses to reason, people of good judgment ascend to divine through a faith untrammeled by sin, and rising, they experience the mystical crucifixion and take pleasure in this figurative, spiritual death. The mystical ecstasy of verse 14 is preceded by an erotic allusion to sexual jouissance in verse 4. I see in your beautiful face, my lord, what can scarcely be related in this life. My soul, although still clothed in its flesh, has already risen often with it to God. The poet's ascent to God in the final verse of this tercet is euphemistically suggestive of a disorienting sensual experience. The description of the soul as clothed, vestita, in flesh, carne, alludes to the lover's concupiscence or lust, as much as to the incarnation of the beloved soul in the body. This characteristically Michelangelo-esque ambivalence is typical of love poems, where in his corpus, where mystical yearning commingles with carnal desire. In Sonnet G94, Michelangelo describes a masochistic creature that wishes to clothe others by shedding its own mortal sheathing in a sacrificial transformative act, just as the poet longs to cover his beloved. Merciful to others and merciless only to itself, a lowly creature is born who with pain and sorrow clothes another's hand and strips off its own skin, and only through death might be called truly born. I wish it were my own fate thus to clothe my lord's living body with my dead hide, so that as a snake sheds its skin on a rock, likewise through death could I change my condition. Oh, if only the furry pelt were mine, which with its woven hair makes such a robe, that has the luck to bind so fair a breast. So I'd have him in the daytime, or the slippers that make themselves a base and support for him, so I might carry him for at least two snows. The animal, vile brutto or bruco, in verse 2, is most often interpreted as a silkworm, bacco da seta. And the article of clothing as a silken glove that evokes the one that the poet Petrarch famously stole from his beloved Laura. In the dialect of the time, bacco da seta, or silkworm, also denoted cavaliere, knight, and this is a pun on the sonnet's dedicatee's name, Tommaso de Cavalieri. In the second quatrain of G94, the image shifts from a worm to a serpent, an erotic symbol of temptation. Were he to lose his mortal sheathing through death, the poet reasons, then he would be transformed like the snake that casts off its slough. The image of the lover's sheared skin has its origins in the Ovidian myth of the flaying of Marsyas, who pridefully challenged Apollo. Sonnet G94 is frequently referenced in discussions of the Last Judgment for this very image, in light of the fact that Michelangelo included a self-portrait in the flayed skin of St. Bartholomew in the Sistine Chapel fresco. The mortal sheathing of St. Bartholomew in the Last Judgment points not only to the saint's resurrection, but also to the poet's attachment to carnality, and by association, concupiscence or lust. Unlike the saint, the poet does not ascend. In G94, Michelangelo's literary persona conveys a hidden wish for the impossible, that his liberated soul ascend while his transformed body remain on earth. He desires both the moral and spiritual benefits of the mystical crucifixion and the sensual delights of his proposed carnal sacrifice. The contrasting of the subjunctive and indicative moods in G94, in red, it also suggests the incommensurable gap between fantasy and reality implicit in the poet's desire to simultaneously purge and embrace sin. The theme of dual desires gave fuller development in Sonnet G76, in which the speaker ponders the etiology of a luminous poker tube that glows within his heart, leading him to tears. I don't know if it is the longed-for light of its first maker which my soul feels, or whether from memories of people some other beauty shines forth in my heart, or whether reports or dreams bring someone before my eyes and present to my heart, leaving behind something unknown and smarting that is perhaps what now leads me to weep. Does he suffer, the speaker asks himself, from the stinging absence of a love object no longer present to him, save as a memory, or because the image within does not correspond to that of God whom he most desires? The beautiful image in the poet's heart pains him. The poet lover, having looked within himself, concludes that what he senses and pursues resides outside the confines of his own being. Other humans seem to point the way to his desired end, presumably through the divine beauty that they reflect. What I feel and seek, and who might guide me to it, are not within me, nor can I see clearly where I might find them, though others seem to show me. The poet feels a divine presence that remains distant enough from its originating source in God that he is impelled to seek him. The speaker cannot find the path to God, though he is elusively perceptible in the faces the lover notices, since meeting his beloved. This, Lord, has happened to me since I saw you. A bitter sweetness, a yes-no feeling moves me. Certainly it must have been your eyes. The poet is conflicted in his attraction, being at once drawn by it and resistant to the pull. Both divine grace and sinful habit seem to drive him. The reference to the beloved's eyes in verse 14 clarifies that the Lord in question is not the second divine person, but rather a living earthly creature. Yet the earlier confusion of Michelangelo's literary persona in discerning the source of his inner images and the direction to which they lead evokes both the tormented lover and the mystical contemplative. Is the poet led to tears from carnal or from celestial longing? The broken heart of the lover and the pierced heart of the convert are simultaneously conjured. The speaker ultimately suffers the plight of both the mystic and the lover. He cannot merge with the creator he perceives in the creature, nor can he refrain from seeing the suggestion of his beloved on the faces of those who cross his path. The love object is at once a divine instrument that enables the poet's salvation, and a temptation that ensures his continued spiritual exile. This paradox is characteristic of Michelangelo's love poetry, and it constitutes an archetypal Christian dilemma that also figures in Michelangelo's art. Michelangelo was a master at rendering Christian mysteries not only visible but also palpable. Many of his iconic images, such as the famed finger of God transmitting his spirit to Adam on the Sistine ceiling, lend themselves naturally, urgently even, to the question of religious mystery, to the relation of humanity to God, if not also to the function of art in Christian devotion. The conflict is omnipresent in Michelangelo's literary and creative production, where it is often framed from the universal perspective of all Christians. Nowhere is this more evident than in the hidden allegory of ascent present in Michelangelo's creation of Adam. Let's view it at an angle 90 degrees, counterclockwise. It's running away with me again. counterclockwise, to the usual upright position. According to the angle of the nude figure, or in utero, you can see his hand right here. We'll go back. Here you have the architectural framework. And you have sculptures that suggest different orientations. And I'm not the first to point out that when standing in the Sistine Chapel's ceiling, of course, you see these images from a variety of angles, not the characteristic angle that it would be viewed from when looking at the images we typically do in a textbook or on a screen. And so this is as viable a viewing point as any, as William Wallace has suggested. And one notices, too, of course, that the overlapping hand is right near Michelangelo's buttocks. And I'm also not the first to point out that that in itself is suggestive. This is a perspective that many in the chapel would have had. And returning to this image thus viewed, the hand is a key, I would argue. The hand down here, rather. A visual rhetorical marker pointing viewers to the fullest meaning of the allegory and the religious mystery to which Michelangelo alludes in this narrative. Adam, observed from this angle, appears to fall backwards down the mountain, away from God's outstretched finger under the weight of his languishing body. A suggestion of his concupiscence and by analogy of the guilt and sinfulness of all humankind. And Michelangelo does refer to a mountain in his poetry, and it is a typical symbol for mystical ascent in the Christian tradition. Michelangelo evokes the fall in his depiction of the very moment of Adam's spiritual incarnation. Adam's weak heavenward reach contrasts more than subtly with God's vigorously extended digit. Both the fall and salvation through God's grace are simultaneously and evocatively conjured in this representation of Adam's creation. Michelangelo almost certainly conceived of his vocation quite literally as a calling. Through his art, he aimed to facilitate the salvation and betterment of its viewers. Michelangelo was concerned to live a just life, centered on the divine, so that he might create, through inspired guidance and skill, spiritually efficacious images. His sacred art was intended to do more than depict a narrative or to enact an ideal. It was meant to catalyze an experience for its viewers. One of the goals of the faithful in contemplating sacred art was to overcome concupiscence and attraction to earthly beauty so as to love God wholly and above all else. The question for the early modern artist was how best to facilitate this moral and spiritual process for viewers. Art must be so beautiful and so emotionally evocative as to be an effective spiritual instrument, but not so pulchritudinous that it generates the opposite of its intended effect, ensnaring and enslaving viewers to the physical instead of fostering their emancipation from it. Viewers must be moved enough to sense their own sinful penchant so that they might be overcome, but not to the extent that, delighting in them, they remain sinners, alienated from God. In his poetry and his art, Michelangelo not only facilitated this process, he described it as one who knew the journey intimately. He captures this distinction between carnal sight and spiritual sight in relation to art in a poem for Vittorio Colonna from the 1540s. As a trustworthy model for my vocation at birth, I was given that ideal of beauty, which is the lamp and mirror of both my arts. If anything otherwise, that opinion is wrong. For this alone can raise the eye to that height which I am preparing here to paint and sculpt. Even though rash and foolish minds drive beauty, which moves every sound mind and carries it to heaven from the senses, unsound eyes can't move from the mortal to the divine, and in fact are fixed forever in that place, from which to rise without grace is a vain thought. For those unable to see clearly the divine beauty Michelangelo captures in his art, grace is the only salvation. An artist seeking to give shape to divine ideas in physical form, Michelangelo's hand had to faithfully produce the conception in his mind, or else he risked failure as an artist, and also as a Christian. Not even the best of artists has any conception that a single marble block does not contain within its excess, and that is only attained by the hand that obeys the intellect. From this excerpt of Michelangelo's perhaps best-known sonnet, let us now turn in conclusion to his unforgettable sculpture, known as the Awakening Slave, one of the prisoners he originally created in the 1520s for Pope Julius II's elaborate tomb. Michelangelo's four unfinished slaves are frequently referenced in discussions of his approach to art. especially his penchant for leaving sculptures unfinished, and his supposed efforts to free with his chisel the nascent idea and ultimate form hidden within a given block of stone. The Awakening Slave, in particular, has been interpreted as a reflection of Michelangelo's own inner torment and his futile attempt to break free from it. I would suggest that in this sculpture, as in other works we have discussed today, the struggle of the Awakening Slave is that of a Renaissance everyman, as Michelangelo understood it. The Christian sinner caught between, on the one hand, weighty carnal desire and pride, symbolized by the cold block of stone itself, and on the other, the soul's yearning for God's presence and the attendant freedom from sin suggested by the prisoner's upward movement. In the Awakening Slave, these incompatible desires are evoked simultaneously by the contours of the slave's emerging body, which is at once serpentine and flame-like, that is, suggestive of both sin and the ascent that results from its divinely mediated transcendence. Ardently ambitious, Michelangelo labored not only in his pursuit of innovation, genius, and artistic excellence, but also in his committed search to secure freedom in many forms, psychological and religious, as well as social and creative. In addition to the more visible external liberties of social mobility and creative license, Michelangelo strove for emancipation of an inner kind, a spiritual and volitional freedom discernible in his verses that tells us as much about his understanding of art and of his vocation. Michelangelo, the poet, struggled to achieve spiritual and psychological freedom in a world where trial was conceived as a divine instrument, hardship could serve as a means of liberation, and self-undoing could be reversed only by the illuminating and guiding force of God. This is just one of the worlds to which his poetry grants us access. And I thank you for exploring it here with me tonight.
Wonderful talk. I enjoyed the conclusions when you say that poetry is just an example of how he struggled. He struggled also in different forms.
In all forms. Yes.
And this is the perfect embodiment. So thank you very much for this metaphor, which is so concrete, actually.
Thank you.
That gives us really an idea of who the man was, how in almost 90 years he went on with this desire to bring spiritual perfection and at the same time being conscious of his earthly essence. I enjoyed the conclusions when you say that poetry is just an example of how he struggled, but he struggled also in different forms.
In all forms.
In all forms.
Yes.
And this is the perfect embodiment. So thank you very much for this metaphor, which is so concrete, actually, that gives us really an idea of who the man was, how in almost 90 years he went on with this desire to bring spiritual perfection and at the same time being conscious of his earthly essence.